Yeah, that's compost. You're dripping wet. You are absolutely dripping wet. What, do you want in here? You can walk around. There's nothing in there. Except maybe crickets. He's good at catching crickets. But the bed is now 3/4 full. It's getting there. It's getting there. Remember I mentioned that it's a work in progress. My garden is a work in progress. And I harvested the potatoes. That was just so much fun. I love that. I don't know what it is about potatoes. It makes me happy. And they're in the basement right now, and they've already cured. They're ready to go. I've already eaten a couple of the purple ones. I like those purple ones. Not as good as russets, but I do like them. But I added more compost in here. And this is that really good stuff that I made last year, and I saved it until this year. And I put that in here, and then I put this year's stuff on top of that. So now it's 3/4 full. I didn't fill it all the way because each year I want to make sure I put the best I can. I could just fill it up full of, you know, crap if I wanted to, but I want good stuff in here. So next year, this is going to be really good. And then I took some compost and filled up the strawberry beds over there. And sorry, get out of my way. This thing is going nuts. I got to harvest some seeds from this. This is that double purple datura. It was this little plant when I planted it this spring. I thought, well, either you live or die. I shoved it in there. And then I shoved this thing in there. This is a canna lily. I keep wanting to call it calla lily, but it's canna lily. And I just shoved this thing in here to take up some space because I had a gap and it went nuts. I don't know where the roots are going, but I know it's not growing in that tiny amount of dirt. It must have sent down roots all the way down past the bottom of the raised bed. I'm going to have to uproot it because I want to bring it inside and try and grow it indoors. So we're going to have an episode on that alone. And then we got the dill over here, but this is the double purple datura, and I've had luck with double purple daturas and the white daturas. They put out a few flowers, they put out some seed pods, they're pretty much done for the season. This one has been flowering, see, flowers, has been flowering and going nuts all summer long. And it's got a stem that I've never seen on one of these before. I can't believe that. So this one's doing good. I gotta harvest some seed pods from that today. Don't forget to remind me of that. And then over here, remember, see, everything's changing. Yeah, since the last time you were here, everything's changing. This was the pea wall. Well, I harvested all the peas from it, and the cucumbers I ate, and those were good. All the way down to the last cucumber, they were good. But they produced awful late. I don't know if English cucumbers just do that because they want to be, you know, crazy, but maybe next year I'll grow something different. Don't really quite know. I like the flavor of the English cucumbers. I just don't like that they were producing all the way to August. I wanted cucumbers a little earlier in the season, so I really don't know what to think about that. But now this bed is totally full of compost. Don't know what I'm going to grow in here next year, but I'll find something good. But today, oh, wait a minute, wrong side. Today, I'm going to be harvesting these. Oh, there's more seeds than I thought. I was doing this for the last 5 minutes, and they won't stop raining seeds. Wow, quite a few seeds for just one little dill head. Oh, look at that. This is called Ducat dill, D-U-K-A-T. And it's a type of dill that it has a lot of good smell to it. But one of the things I really like about it is it puts out a ton of seeds per seed head. It doesn't put out these little tiny seed heads. It puts out huge seed heads, a lot of good seeds. The plant grows lower than most dill. And I like that. I don't need dill that's taller than me. I don't need to be impressing anybody. I like a dill that's a little bit lower so it doesn't shade everything else around it. And I got plenty of seeds. Yep. I'm going to dry these on this plate, and then I'm going to store the plate. I don't toss my plates away. I reuse them over and over and over. I have plates that I've been using for up to 5 years in the voodoo garden. And I use them to dry seeds on and to demonstrate stuff on. But I make sure I don't toss them away because that is really, really bad for the environment. And I don't want to destroy the earth anymore than I absolutely have to because somebody's got to live here when I'm gone. Anyway, back to what I was doing. Seed. Done. That was really easy. And that's only off of one head. Can you imagine how many seeds I could get if I harvested all of the dill that's all along the row here? I get a lot. But I want to leave the rest of the dill because I have a visitor over here I want to show you. And here it is. This is the caterpillar of the yellow swallowtail butterfly. There are different types of swallowtails, and their caterpillars look very similar, but this one is for a yellow swallowtail, and I have the, and I know this because I see the yellow swallowtails all over my yard. This is a caterpillar, and generally no caterpillar is a good caterpillar when it comes to your garden because they basically eat green stuff. That's what they do, and they do it extremely well. They are eating machines, and if you see these on your dill, You can pluck them off and just toss them over the fence and let your neighbors worry about it, or put them somewhere else. And they will lay eggs on dill, because dill is one of their favorite foods. I have about 6 of these caterpillars going here, and I just leave them there because I have more than enough dill for everybody. So I try to share as much as I possibly can. You know, I'm not trying to be Mr. Nature or anything, but I don't go destroying critters unless I absolutely, positively have to. That's just how I work things. But if you don't have dill, you may still have these, because these love carrot greens. Yep, I found a couple on the carrots, and I wanted to make sure they didn't eat my carrot greens, because I'm doing pretty good on carrots. So I actually pluck a leaf off the carrot, and then I lay it on top of the dill, and then they'll crawl onto the dill. You don't want to grab these things, because what'll happen is, I found this out, I didn't want to demonstrate it because I don't want to be mean to these guys. If you grab them, they have orange horns that come out of, I think, their butt. I really can't tell one side from the other. But I grabbed one, and all of a sudden these orange horns, 2 of them, shot out of their butt or head. And I thought, what the heck is going on here? And I put it on the dill, and then I noticed a stink. Yeah, I noticed a stink, and it was my fingers. That's their defense mechanism. So I went in and washed that stuff off. I was picking beans that day, and I didn't want my beans to smell like caterpillar horn reek, or whatever you want to call it. No, they're not. Well, they got to do something to protect themselves. They don't want you messing with them. It is fascinating just how much these things can eat. They're little pigs, they are. Yep. Well, I'm glad I have plenty of dill for them. Chow down. I'm done with it. Okay, what's next? Ooh, tomatoes. I have some tomatoes. And remember, I planted Boxcar Willie. At least I thought I planted Boxcar Willie. I don't think I planted Boxcar Willie. I have something that I want to show you, and I already took a picture of it, and I showed some friends, and I don't think that these are Boxcar Willie. But what I'm actually very happy about is the size and the look of these tomatoes. I want you to see these things and tell me what you think, okay? Tell me what you think of these tomatoes. And this is what I'm talking about. Let me snip one off real quick so you can see it. Careful. Normally, I just grab them and I pull them off, but I want to make absolutely positively certain that I don't damage this plant, because it's really doing something fantastic. It's growing the most beautiful tomatoes I've ever seen in my life. And I'm not just bragging. I want you to see this tomato. Look at this. All the way around. Is this just beautiful? It is the picture perfect tomato. No blossom end rot, no gouges, no holes in it, no nothing. And look at the size. This is a beautiful specimen of a tomato, I gotta admit. And I don't know what this is. I've been trying to figure this out since I featured this in an episode before. And look, there's another one here, here. There are 2 more back there that I have to pick. So I'm gonna be picking 5 of these today off of this one plant. Yes, growing off one plant. The other plant is in the back, and it hasn't started producing as much. But this one gets a little bit more sunlight, and it's doing very well. Now, off the same exact plant, right over here, I'm not even going to use the snippers. I'm just going to pull this one right off. Hold on. Okay. The same plant puts this out. Okay, now this would look more like a Boxcar Willie. I know this is awful small. It would be a small Boxcar Willie, and it's hard to imagine that these two are related. They don't look anything alike, do they? No, they don't. And these are off the same exact plant. Strange indeed, isn't it? Very strange. I have no idea what's going on, but I've tasted one of these. I picked one so far, and I sliced it. It was beautiful. It was juicy. It had plenty of meat inside, and the flavor was fantastic. I actually had it on a burger. First, I took it, sliced it in half, and I took the top half and cut it in wedges, cut out the center, and it was delicious. I took the bottom half and made a couple slices and had them on a couple burgers. It was beautiful both ways. So I'm very, very happy with this. It gets to be about an orangish red, a really dark orange when it's ripe. So this one is just about perfect. I'm gonna put this on the counter, let it set for a couple days and let it finish ripening, and then I'm gonna eat this. But look, it's a beauty, isn't it? And this is August, and the blight hasn't really gone crazy. We've got a couple leaves in here, no biggie. Every now and then, like I say, I just remove the leaves, toss them aside, get on with my day. But the plants are looking really good. Smells good too. Wow. This is a good year. This is a very good year for gardening. I'm very happy with this. But this beauty, I don't know. I really like the idea of growing Boxcar Willies because, like I said, they are my favorite tomatoes. So I may look for seeds online. But I may just save seeds for this because this is tempting me. A plant that can produce such beauties. I've grown brandywine. I've grown brandywine. I've grown beefsteak tomatoes of all different sizes. And I have yet to find one that would produce such a beauty and not strain the plant. You know, normally when you have a big tomatoes, you really have to prop the heck out of these plants. So this one put out nice, strong branches. I had to tie them to my Gilligan's Island type trellis here. But it wasn't to where it was like this spidery looking plant that was being trellised up. It was actually a very nice, healthy plant. And I think if I planted this indoors and got it a good start earlier in the season, I would have gotten these tomatoes a lot earlier. So I'm very happy with the production. So I may just grow this again next year, along with Boxcar Willie and of course the Prax Cherry. So not a bad tomato. I'm very happy with this. Oh. Now I want to show you something else. It's definitely show and tell in the garden. Check this out over here. As if I didn't have enough going on in this one raised bed. And by the way, no, this raised bed is not going to produce enough food for one person to last a year. Let's just go ahead and get that on the table. No, it's not going to do that. I'm having good luck with the tomatoes, but there's nowhere near enough tomatoes to get me for a whole year. My peppers got eaten by my tomato plants. My onions are doing okay. My carrots are doing okay. My beans are doing okay. Prax cherries are doing okay, but no. Now, I was a little bit ambitious because I didn't have this bed quite filled with soil and I just wanted to try something out, but no, it's not going to work out, but I'm still having a good time. But I wanted to show you something. This thing here, I don't know what to do with this. This is one happy plant and I've been doing this every single day like clockwork. You could set your clock to the amount of times I go through here and I'm pruning off this ridiculous vine. This, I don't know what it is. Remember at the very first of the season when I was planting my onions and stuff, when I was just planting the garden, I had this little vine and it was growing inside in the voodoo garden and I don't remember what it is. I didn't label it. Yeah, I don't label things and boy, am I living to regret that. I had this little vine growing inside the voodoo garden and it was from seeds somebody sent me. So one of you out there, this is yours. And I don't know what it is. And it started vining and I thought, well, I'll just plant it over here and it can grow right along the side of the bed and it'll be kind of cute. Well, it's no longer cute. This baby Huey has grabbed a hold of this little fence thing that I used to keep the cats out. And look, I don't know what this is. Take a close-up look at these leaves. Okay, I don't know. It's not fruiting. It's not flowering. But it is definitely growing. It went over there and it started beating the heck out of the tomatoes. So I had to take my snippers and beat it up. Then it went over there and it grabbed the Prax cherries and was strangling them. So I had to beat it up. And now it's reaching down, as you can see. And it's trying to grab the carrots and pull them out of the ground, which I'm not going to allow. I don't know what this is, but I hope it's something I like because I really do like the way that it grows. All you have to do is water the thing and it goes nuts and it just vine. The more you cut off, the more it gets. This is crazy. Take a look at the leaves and see if you can identify this. I know there's somebody out there that can identify this for me. And I honestly do want to identify this because I want to know what I'm growing. Maybe it's poison ivy. Let me rub it all over me. Take a look at this. It's a beautiful leaf, isn't it? Yeah, it's strong. They don't wilt during the sun. You know how sunflowers and pumpkin leaves will wilt. This leaf does not wilt. And if I forget to water it, it's okay. If I water it too much, it's okay. This plant is the most user-friendly plant I've ever grown in my life. And the vines, let me snip off one of these random strangle my other plant type of vines and show you what it looks like when it vines out. This is what it looks like on the growing tip. I want to give you as many views as I can. Puts out tendrils and those tendrils grab everything in sight. And I know it's not a grapevine. I know it sort of looks like a grapevine, but no, it's definitely not a grapevine. The younger leaves may look like grapevines, but let me tell you something, these are not grapevines. No, these are definitely not grapevines. I wish they were. Boy, I would have the most healthy grapes on anywhere on YouTube. Yeah, I would love for this to be a grapevine, but I know it's not. It's some kind of a gourd, maybe? Or I don't know. What is it, folks? Let me know. Way down in the jungle, underneath the sunflower. This is my shade tree. Yep. Sunflower is my shade tree, but I'm growing what's called pumpkin on a stick. Pumpkin on a stick. Yeah, they do look exactly like pumpkins. Somebody sent me seeds for this, or did I buy these seeds? Oh, I don't know. Somehow I got seeds in my possession, and I decided to grow this thing just as a novelty. And it's not really much of a novelty. This is a producer. I'm snipping these things off all day long. Look at this. Don't they look like little pumpkins? Kind of cute, aren't they? But these are definitely not pumpkins. No, they're not. These are an eggplant. Yeah, they're an eggplant. And from what I understand, they're a little bit bitter, and they are used in some type of Thai or Vietnamese cooking. Not really quite sure. And you know me, I don't like the taste of eggplants. I don't like them at all. And every time I say that, everybody gives me recipes for them. Like, Ray, try it like this. And I'm thinking, I don't like them. Why are you giving me recipes if I tell you I don't like it? You know, I don't like being punched in the gut, but you cannot give me different methods of punching me in the gut that's going to make it more palatable. I don't like eggplants. But you know what's really weird? I don't like the flavor of eggplants of any sort, but I grow them like nobody grows eggplants. I seem to have a knack for it, you know? Everybody has a talent. You know, I know that we all do. Everybody has some sort of talent. And I have a talent for growing eggplants. And I don't know why. I wish I had this kind of talent with everything else I grew, because I would love to be able to grow so successfully something that I really, really love, like, I don't know, hamburgers. Ooh, spiderweb. That can't be good. Well, it can't be good for me. I don't like reaching in here and having spiders. You know, that is just one of those things that you have to tolerate as a gardener. The other day I found this huge spider on the other side of the yard. Thank goodness it wasn't. Oh, there's a spider making its escape. Bye. Go on. Get off my plant. I got things to do. Come on, I got things to do. Okay, these are the beans. Yeah, I don't need clippers for that. Beans. These are the Landreth stringless beans, and I've been coming out here on a daily basis. You know, I don't know how people with gardens ever take a day off. I don't. I don't know how anybody else would. Oh, there. Because once you start getting beans in your garden, you got to pick them every day. And if you don't pick them every day, well, that's what I have to do. I have to pick them every single freaking day. Otherwise, they turn into these gargantuan, tough beans that nobody even wants to think about eating. And so yeah, I'm picking beans all the time. It's amazing how many beans you can get from just a couple plants. It's just crazy. So when you're doing beans, you definitely want to make sure you don't overplant. Otherwise, you're going to be bothering everybody with beans, and eventually they're going to stop answering their door. Yeah, I've been picking beans like mad, and it looks like I manhandle these plants, but that's just how I've always done it. And ooh, it's a little bit damp in here. I better stop watering over here. Yep. Well, anyway, on to something less ugly. But no, I've been picking beans like mad and producing, saving them for winter in Ziploc bags. I just blanch them. I just take off the ends, blanch them in a little hot water, and then throw them into Ziplocs, push out the air, and that's how I preserve them. I don't do them in jars because I just don't like the texture of them when they're in jars like that. And I don't have enough jars. I want to save those for something else. I don't want to go buying more jars either. Plus, it's hot in the kitchen. I don't want to do that. No. Ooh, there's another one. And they just hide in there, don't they? Yep. But back to what I was talking about, manhandling the plants, is what happens is that these plants get really, really thick. And then I'm yanking out dead pieces like this and throwing it on the ground and letting the insects eat them. And I can get to the beans a lot easier. And from what I've experienced, not what I've read, I don't read much, I just experience a lot. From what I've experienced, hey, have a bean. Anyway, from what I've experienced, you're yanking out parts of these plants and manhandling them, what seems to happen is I get more beans. I don't know what it is, domestic violence on my plants. I think it's because I'm picking out parts of the plants and I'm opening it up a little bit, because you can see how clustered this is. I'm opening up the plants so the insects can actually get down there and find the flowers. That's the only thing I can think of. I have no idea. Oop, there we go. There's more. Yep, my daily beans. There's flowers all over this thing. And my final harvest of the day. Yeah, I'm just skip jumping all over the place, but that's usually how I do it. No rhyme or reason. I don't need a rhyme or reason. I wanted to make sure I did these last because I didn't want to touch this plant and then go touching everything else in the garden. These are the double purple detours, as I mentioned. And what happens is they put out their flowers and then they get pollinated and then they form this big seed pod. Different types of datura put out different types of seed pods. The common one is the white datura, the one they call devil's trumpet, and it grows like a weed. And it actually is a weed. A lot of people don't like this growing on their property. But anyway, it'll put out a spiked, it looks like a sea urchin, and it puts out a spiked seed pod, and then inside are the seeds. And then one day out of nowhere, no warning whatsoever, it goes boom, and it bursts open, and seeds go flying all over the place, and that's how it spreads itself. This one does the same thing, only its seed pod looks a little bit different, a little bit more exotic as far as I'm concerned. Whether you like it or you don't like it, you have to admit that this plant is definitely a survivor. It grows exponentially like nothing I've ever seen. And in order to understand it, you have to start way down at the bottom, and that's where we're gonna go. When I planted this, it was just this tiny little plant, and look at how big the stem has gotten. This is like a woody trunk. Yeah, almost like a bonsai tree, isn't it? It's quite beautiful. It fell over when I first planted it, and I thought it was gonna die, but nope. It had other plans. It just spreads out, and look, see, seed pod. But what it does is it spreads out all over the place. It grows down, but it also grows up. It doesn't put out roots where parts of the stem touch the soil, not like a tomato or anything. But what it does is it'll fork, then each fork will fork, and then each fork of that will fork. So yes, you get this pyramid effect, and at the end of each one of them, you get flowers. You get lots of flowers. And even though it may be a noxious weed, it does definitely bring in the pollinators. And that is something that I like in my garden. There is no bad pollinator in the garden as far as I'm concerned. As long as it brings those insects in, I'm happy. The flowers don't stay beautiful for long. This one is a two-day-old flower. Yeah, it's not looking very good. I don't have any freshly bloomed flowers to show you, but I'll put a picture up at the end of this program, and you can see what a freshly bloomed flower looks like. It is a work of art. Nature is one heck of an artist when it comes to its flowers, isn't it? Let me show you something way down at the bottom. What happens to the flowers once they close up and form seeds? These are the seed pods. These are polka dotted. Yeah, just a polka dotted pod. Let me snip one off. And this is what it looks like. And what'll happen is this pod will grow and grow. Then it'll stop growing. And that's when you know it's starting to ripen. I can't tell you when to pick these because I really don't know myself. Once they're fully formed and as large as they're going to get, I leave them on there for a couple weeks. Then I pluck them and set them on a paper plate and rinse them off first. Then I take them inside, put them in the voodoo garden. Then one morning I go in there and it's busted open and the seeds are falling out of it. That's when I harvest the seeds. Yep, I'm going to get plenty of seeds from this one, and I'm going to spread them all over my property because I definitely like the smell of these. They put out their flowers at night and it just fills the air with the most beautiful smell. Boy, these things are getting huge, aren't they? These folks are called Jerusalem artichokes. Jerusalem artichokes are commonly known as sunchokes. People eat the roots or tubers or whatever they're called, rhizomes. I don't know the technical term. Somebody's going to correct me, but whatever they are, they look kind of like ginger. And Joe, a viewer, a friend of mine, he's been watching the program for many, many years, and he sent me a box of these because he grows them in his yard. He sent me a few of these, and I say just a few because I planted about maybe, I don't know, 6 or 8 last year around this old stump. When I moved here, this was an old dead tree. What I did is I had a contractor come in and removed this monstrous dead tree and push all the dead stuff off the yard, and I have this trunk. And when I did one of my first programs here, I squatted down here and I talked to you from this stump. I planted the Jerusalem artichokes around here. I planted, I think, maybe 8. And from just those 8, last year I got a few of these coming up and I was really happy with them and they had flowers and stuff. I left them there over the winter hoping that they would come back, but really not quite sure because I didn't plant them that deep. Well, I got to admit, I really phoned it in. I was just taking the shovel, moving them over there, shoving them in there. I planted some over by the road, which didn't grow, and some at the end of the yard, which didn't grow. So I really didn't have much hope for these. Well, they did okay last year, and I was wondering if they'd come back this year. Well, this spring, it's a story, but it's a short story. Well, this spring, I had the chickens out here free ranging. And you know chickens, if you've ever had chickens. Chickens are like scratch, scratch, peck, roll around in it, scratch, scratch, peck. Well, that out of all these acres that I have, everywhere these ridiculous velociraptors could possibly want to go, they chose this stump. And they hung around this stump and they were digging up my Jerusalem artichokes. I came out here and the chickens were all going nuts, like they just found something delicious. And I came out here and they were eating a Jerusalem artichoke root. And I thought, you little buggers, get out of here. And so I fenced them in. I fenced the chickens in because they were just turning my yard into this moonscape. And I really didn't think I was going to get anything. But look, look, this is what happens. 8 bulbs or whatever they are turned into this. And it's going to, and people say, hey, Ray, watch out when you plant those things. They're going to spread. They are. They're spreading. And these ones back here, my yard is on a slope, but still, the ones back there are over 8 feet tall. And they show no signs of slowing down. And what happens with these things is they grow multiple, well, they'll grow up like a sunflower. They're very similar to a sunflower. And then what'll happen is after they get so tall, they'll start putting out side shoots. Unlike a sunflower, they'll naturally put out side shoots. And those side shoots will put out more side shoots. And then in the fall, as if this isn't good enough, in the fall, all of a sudden, bang, you get these huge yellow daisy-like flowers. They're similar to sunflowers. And it's a splash of yellow that is just amazing. And it's a great send-off for the season, isn't it? The last thing of the season, you think everything's going to die. All of a sudden, bang, out comes the Jerusalem artichokes. And what a sight it is. But I wanted to show you these because I've been dying to show you. And I've been hinting about it, but here they are, folks. These are the Jerusalem artichokes, and they are definitely spreading. The way I keep them from spreading all over my yard is my riding lawnmower. I mow around these things, and anything that goes outside a certain circle gets mowed down. What I'm going to do, though, is probably in the spring, early spring, when the ground thaws out, I'm going to come out here, and I'm going to dig up a lot of these bulbs, and I'm going to plant them around the side of my yard, way out at the perimeter. Because I may want to be planting more grass around here or some flowers or something. So I may dig these up and then move them to the side of my property and then surround my property with Jerusalem artichokes. But I probably won't get all of these. So every now and then one of these is going to pop up. And yes, they are invasive, but I didn't plant them in my garden. So they're doing just fine. I don't really go for that. Hey, it's invasive. Because I got morning glories. I got Jerusalem artichokes. I got all kinds of fun stuff growing here. But I take care of it, you know. It won't invade if I take care of it. Like the morning glories, they're not invading my garden because I mow my yard. And, you know, if those morning glories want to try and grow past the lawnmower, they can give it their best shot. But I don't think they're going to make it. But these are beautiful. These are absolutely beautiful. And I want to thank Joe personally. Thank you, Joe. Thank you so much for making my day just that much brighter. These are amazing. And your plants are doing just great on my property. Thank you very much for that. And I hope you guys are enjoying these. I'm going to give you another shot once they bloom. So this is the last shot when they're green. The next time you see them, they're going to be in full bloom. Hey, baby doll. Yeah, it's a tomato. It's one of those mornings. It's that time of the year when it's hot during the day, but in the morning, you have the morning dew all over everything. So when you walk around, you get it all over your shoes. When you're a dog the size of a loaf of bread, you come back so soggy. But what he really likes is the sun comes up over the trees, it gets on the porch, and he sits on the porch and he totally dries out. And it's just beautiful out here because you can see the steam coming up off the plants and stuff. It's a beautiful look. It really is. Hey, you want to come over here and say goodbye? Come here. But Daddy, it's wet. You don't understand. You have shoes. Oh, you poor thing. Well, thank you, everybody, for joining me for this episode. I really do appreciate it. I'll see you next time in the garden. Have a great day. Okay, there. See, I did it. Let's go.